love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. You've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. You've done for me.
Would you please be seated?
There is
From sin, conquer death, rise from the grave, and then hold us firmly in your grip, Lord, until you come or until you call us home. It is you and you alone, Lord, that we worship this morning, for it is you and you alone who is our Savior and Lord and friend. And so we worship you this morning. It's in your name that we pray, and all the church said, amen. Well, now you can go ahead and wave to all those around you, say hello. Wave to people at home. I think we were having some difficulties earlier in the service, but those should be over with. So if you're watching at home, if anything does go wrong, just leave us a comment. We can see it. We can fix it as we go through. So hopefully you're all with us there. But go ahead and grab your bulletins. We've got some announcements to go over, some different things coming up. As we sang in that song, right? Until he returns or calls me home. Earlier this week, Our good friend, longtime church member, former elder in our church, John Dobbs, was called home on Wednesday night at home with his precious wife there by his side. And so we are offering our deepest condolences and prayers to the Dobbs family. We all know them well and their children and grandchildren. There will be a private graveside service on Tuesday morning, so just be praying for the family there, for the entire Dobbs family, if you will, all this week. But we have other announcements as well. Next Sunday, you know, interestingly, this week is the one-year anniversary of when things got shut down here at Congregational Bible Church, and you know, we want to bring things back, and so we're trying to think of how can we equip our people even in times like this. And so next Sunday, the 21st, at 9:45, normally that Sunday school hour, we're going to do our baptism information class. So if you are a confessing believer in Christ who has never been baptized, this is the class for you, where you can come and you can hear and you can listen all that Scripture says about baptism. And then we will have the baptism later on. April 11th is the day we're shooting for baptisms after church here in the quad, which should be a pretty fun time. So put that on your calendar. Also, if you are considering membership at Congregational Bible Church, we're going to have a three-part membership class. A three-part membership class, same thing, that Sunday school hour, April 18th, 25th, and May 2nd. The dates are there. So put those on your calendar if you're thinking of membership. Also, if you're thinking of membership and haven't been baptized, you should go to the baptism class first before the membership class. But of course, you know, we're flexible with all of that. If one of those days you can't make it, we can meet another time and we can fill those times in. So just put those down on your calendar. There's a youth movie night that's going on this Friday night at the Hunter's House at 7 o'clock p.m. So all junior high and high school, make note of that. Vacation Bible School, VBS, is going to come up this summer, July 12th. You know, everything, we were all ready for it last year, and then it didn't happen. So we got everything. We're ready to go. Okay? We just need the volunteers for that. So July 12th through 16th in the evenings, you can sign up on the bulletin board there in the hallway. Let Pastor Spencer know if you would like to volunteer or what you'd like to do to serve in that area for VBS in the summer. On the back, we do have a couple of corrections, but just to let you know of Bible studies and things going on Wednesday night, we continue here. Youth group is going on as well. We're here in the sanctuary. There are a number of people that come in person. There's plenty of space. There's plenty of room to spread out. We do that here for the live stream, for being able to do the live stream. So you're more than welcome to attend in person on Wednesday night as we continue to understand spiritual warfare. What it means to, this week we're going to look at understanding the strategies and schemes of Satan and how he tries to trick believers and catch them in, as the Bible says, snares and tricks. So we will look at that this Wednesday night on the Thursday morning ladies meeting every Thursday. Anchored is not meeting tonight, but the Word Bible Study is, so that's one of the corrections. The Word Bible Study is meeting tonight at 6:30. At the Gehrings House, so make note of that. And then the Pillars Bible Study, the men's Bible study we used to do on Saturday mornings, we're going to start to get that rolling again. And so make one little change in there. It'll be at 7 a.m. So sorry, all of you. Thought you could sleep in. It's not happening. 7 a.m. if you want to be a part of come to Pillars on Saturday morning at Tin Cup Coffee, okay? And there's a lot of announcements, but that's good, right? It's good to be able to say, here we go, we got this going on here in church. So thank you. All right. We heard an amen. At this time, we're going to have Danny Garcia. He's going to come up, and he's going to lead us in scripture and prayer. And then after that, we will be singing a hymn together.
Good morning. I was just thinking the same thing. It's nice to be able to sit in the pew and hear all the activities that are being planned and kind of let's hopefully get back to some normalcy in the way we worship and the way we fellowship with each other. So we will go, we're going to do some scripture reading first. So Lamentations chapter 3, verse 19 through 26. That's page 822 in your pew Bible. 822, Lamentations 3, 19 through 26. Remember my affliction and my wandering, the wormwood and the bitterness. Surely my soul remembers and is bowed down within me. This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. The Lord's loving kindness indeed never cease, for his compassion never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the person who seeks him. It is good that he waits silently for the salvation of the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Great Heavenly Father, we once again come before you on Sunday and to worship you, to praise you, to hear your word. We thank you for that opportunity, Lord. We thank you for the countless blessings you have provided us, our church, our families, and that you've entrusted with us, Lord, through this last challenging year. Again, Lord, I think we have seen your grace and your love. We've learned new ways to worship you. We've learned new ways to honor you, Lord, and we just thank you for that. Father, as we look back in your word and the afflictions Jeremiah faced, let's learn a lesson from Jeremiah, and let us trust in you, Lord, as we've learned to do this last year. Let us depend on you, to wait on you, knowing our obedience and faith in you will result in blessings from you. Lord, I pray we recognize every new morning as a new morning of your mercies, your love, and your faithfulness to us, which never cease. We thank you for this, and I pray that for us to always have the faith in you, and when we're faced with affliction within our own lives, to turn to you, Lord, and to have faith that you will see us through. Father, I pray for those who are on our hearts and minds who may not be saved. There are those that we know that still need salvation, Lord, and we pray for their salvation. We pray for an opportunity to minister them. They may be family members, friends, co-workers, but we just pray for that opportunity to share your love, to share your grace. And I pray that when those opportunities are presented to us, that we would not shy away, Lord, that we would seek those opportunities to share your word, to share your love, Lord. I pray for our leaders, both nationally and locally, Lord. We pray that they would put you first. As we see in the news and just the day-to-day, there's divide, and there's clearly opportunity, Lord, for our leaders to seek you more, and I pray that they would. I pray that they would lay their decisions at your feet, and they would seek your word and your guidance when making decisions as they represent us and they represent our country, Lord. Father, as we finally go into the sermon, recognizing that we are all sinners, we need you, Lord, in our life. We need to seek you in our daily walk, Lord, and I pray that we do. We're not worthy of the incredible gift you've given us of salvation, but your grace and your love, you've bestowed that upon us, and I pray that we honor you for that gift in our actions and in our words. And now as we go into the sermon, I pray that you quiet our minds and you open our hearts, and that we, as always, learn something new, Lord, and learn something greater about you, because we are in awe of you, of your majesty, Lord, and we pray that you be with us as we walk out these doors today. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now would you please stand and join us as we sing Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's hymn number 98, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
My Father, there is
Well, at this time, all those in Children's Church may be dismissed. And as they are filing out, I encourage you to turn in your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. I believe it's page 1185. I wrote it down, yeah. 1185 in the Pew Bible, if you're using a Pew Bible. 2 Thessalonians 3. I'm going to read the first 5 verses here of 2 Thessalonians 3. It says, "Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord will spread rapidly and be glorified, just as it did also with you, and that we will be rescued from perverse and evil men, for not all have faith. But the Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. We have confidence in the Lord concerning you, that you are doing and will continue to do what we command. May the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the steadfastness of Christ. The Lord's great faithfulness, the faithfulness of the Lord. Looking back on your life, maybe in photos and photo albums, or just reflecting on different periods, areas of your life, phases of your life, different people may have played prominent roles in your life at different times. Maybe the friends that you had in your college years, you don't really keep up with them anymore, and they're not really friends with you. Or maybe you hear your parents talk about people that you've never met. You go, I don't know who those people are. I've never met them. They were friends long before you were ever born. When I was in high school, I had a best friend. We did absolutely everything together. We were just always together. It was assumed. Mark and Teal were always together. We were attached at the hip, and then we went off and went to different colleges, and we started to not talk very often, and then eventually we just kind of dropped out of contact with one another, and that happens in life. Friends come and friends go. People come and people go. Most people don't have the same friends that they've done their entire life. It's not really someone's fault. You just kind of drift away. That commitment, that reliance on one another, that faithfulness to the relationship just kind of dwindles and eventually goes away. But in stark contrast to that is the faithfulness of the Lord. The Lord's faithfulness to his people. He is faithful. And that relationship and that commitment he has to his people, it never fades away. He is committed. He is dependable. He is reliable. That is the idea of faithful. Our text this morning emphasizes the faithfulness of our Lord, the faithfulness of Christ. The statement is made there in verse 3, but the Lord is faithful. And I would submit to you that that thought in Paul's mind really governs the entire text that I read. It's foremost in his thoughts all the way through. Because why, as he says in verse 1, pray for us? Why ask for people to pray for him if the Lord was not faithful to answer those prayers, right? Why promise the people in verse 3 he'll strengthen and protect you from the evil one? Why promise them that if the Lord was not faithful to do it? Why, as verse 4 says, we have confidence in the Lord? Why would he have confidence in the Lord if the Lord was not faithful? This text kind of reads like some call it the pastoral wish list, you might say. Pray for us in verse 1. We want you to obey, verses 4 and 5. May God direct your heart into the love of God. All of those expressed wishes he has fall under the truth that the Lord is faithful. That's why he says what he says. He always fulfills his end of the bargain because he's faithful. He's reliable, trustworthy, dependable. Faithfulness is one of his attributes. It is a necessary part of his being. And just thinking of two just wonderful thoughts of the Lord's faithfulness as we think about this, his faithfulness can never decrease. Just think about that for a minute. His faithfulness can never lessen. It can never break down. It is fixed and unchanging. So that means never will the Lord become less faithful. He cannot, because it is one of his perfections, it's one of his attributes. But also that means that his faithfulness cannot increase. He can never become more faithful because he's already perfectly faithful. And so he never has to improve upon his faithfulness because it is already perfect. And you do a word search of the word faithfulness in Scripture, and you will find the Lord's faithfulness declared all over the place. In Exodus 34:6, the Lord announces about himself that he is abounding in, the translation there is loving kindness. It's the word faithful. As he says about himself, Deuteronomy 7:9, he is the faithful God. 1 Kings 3 and 8, when Solomon is looking back on how the Lord has dealt with his father David, he said, "You have been faithful to my father David." 1 Chronicles 16:34, "His faithfulness is everlasting." In Nehemiah chapter 9, Nehemiah says, "We have acted sinfully, but you have been faithful." Psalm 36:5, "Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds." Psalm 89, "I will make your faithfulness known with my mouth." It is something to be spoken of, the great faithfulness of God. We read it earlier, Lamentations 3:23, as Jeremiah watched Jerusalem burn, he declared, "Great is your faithfulness." God is even faithful to his promises of judgment. It's throughout the Old Testament. It's also throughout the New Testament. 1 Corinthians 1:9, God is faithful. 1 Corinthians 10:13, God is faithful. 2 Corinthians 1:18, God is faithful. 1 Thessalonians 5:24, faithful is he who calls you. Here, 2 Thessalonians 3:3, the Lord is faithful. The Bible proclaims the faithfulness of the Lord, but how does the Lord demonstrate his faithfulness? How is that faithfulness shown? How is it revealed? Well, our text here, it tells us. Five examples of the Lord's great faithfulness in this text. Five examples of the Lord's great faithfulness, which should increase our trust and our reliance on him as being perfectly faithful in all things as we go through our life. And I submit to you, number one, he is faithful to answer prayer. He is faithful to answer prayer. As Paul says in verse 1, he asks the congregation to pray for him. Finally, brethren, he's moving on to a new topic. This is coming to the close of the letter. Finally, brethren, pray for us. And then he lists his prayers. You know, the prayers of Paul are just saturating the books of 1 and 2 Thessalonians. You have prayers of Paul in 1 Thess 1, 2, 3, and 5. You have prayers of Paul in 2 Thessalonians, the beginning of chapter 1, the end of chapter 1. Chapter 2 just ended with a prayer. And now he says, pray for us. Pray for us. He really was a prayer warrior, wasn't he? But Paul was not prideful to the point where he doesn't need to ask for prayer. Paul understands, I too need your prayers, and I am not shy to ask. His prayer, as you see in verse 1, is for the word to spread, for the word to be glorified, and then verse 2, that we would be rescued. Those are his prayer requests. Why does Paul pray so much? And why does he ask the people to pray for him? Because he knows the Lord is faithful to answer prayer. That's what he knows. There is not one prayer that the Lord ignores. There is not one missed prayer. Sorry, he's not in at the moment. Check back later. Every single prayer listened to and answered. Sometimes I think we'll admit we didn't really like the answer to that prayer. But it was answered, wasn't it? Was the Lord faithful to answer it? Yes, he was. It gets answered in his will and for his glory. And that's really what prayer is. It's aligning our wants and our desires, submitting them to the Lord, and putting them up, as it will, onto the chopping block of his will. Submitting our requests to him. Prayer is not changing God's mind. How foolish would it be for us to try to change God's mind? It would be like me telling a surgeon, you know what, you should really cut there. Or telling a pilot, you know, you probably should press that button now. No, I'm ignorant of those things, and we are woefully ignorant of the perfect knowledge of God, who knows all things, the past, the present, the future, the hearts and minds of every single man, woman, child. That is what God knows. The one working all things under the counsel of his will, he doesn't need advice. He doesn't need information on how to improve certain circumstances. Prayer is not changing God's thoughts. Prayer is submitting our thoughts to his will. But it's encouraging to know that God is faithful to answer prayer, is it not? That's why he asked them to pray for him. I want you to pray for me because I trust in my God who is faithful to answer those prayers that you offer for me. It's not that your prayers are so great. It's that God is so faithful to answer them. And you know why the Lord is so faithful to answer prayer? Not just because he said he would, which is enough of a reason. Why does God love to answer prayer so much? Because it is us humbling ourselves to the point of saying, God, I need your help. God, I need you. I can't do this on my own. Prayer is the ultimate abandonment of self-reliance and saying, Lord, unto you do I turn. That's why it pleases God so much, is because we turn to him and say, God, we need your help. If you're a parent and you see your child struggling to do something, maybe a task or something, they're trying to open a jar, they're trying to solve a math problem, and you're standing nearby, and what are you just waiting for them to say? Help me. And you want to jump right in and help. When you finally come to the end of your rope and you turn to God in prayer, God is overjoyed with that, and God is faithful to answer it. He's faithful to answer prayer. Secondly, he's faithful to bless his word. He's faithful to bless his word. The specifics of the request in verse 1, pray for us that the word of the Lord will spread rapidly and be glorified. His prayer is for the word. It's not for him. He's not praying for his likes to increase, for his downloads to increase, for his followers to increase. Pray for the word to grow. And by the word here, he's talking about the gospel. May the gospel of Jesus Christ spread rapidly. That's what I want you to pray. And really, two things in regards to the gospel: that it would spread rapidly and that it would be received. That's the idea of that it would be glorified, that people would respond to it. So he's asking for prayer that it would advance quickly and that it would be received and that God would be glorified. To spread rapidly is literally the word run. Pray that the gospel would run, sprint across these cities, across the nations. Pray that it would run directly into the hearts of listeners. Pray for as many people to hear the gospel as possible. Pray for it to go at warp speed. And pray for people to receive it, respond to it, hear it. And that's the idea, that it would be glorified. Pray for it to be glorified, that people might get saved. Nothing brings God more glory than when a sinner responds to the gospel. Luke chapter 15. Remember the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin? There's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than 99 who don't need any repentance. A celebration in heaven goes on every time a soul is saved. Paul says, pray that the word, the gospel, sprints throughout the nations and that it is received and that God is glorified. But why does he ask this specifically? Because he knows that God is faithful to honor his word. God will honor his word. God will bless his word. Psalm 138, verse 2, it says, God's word is magnified according to his name. That means God has linked his word to his great name. His name is tied to his word. That's how important biblical, correct preaching and teaching is. Because if you get it wrong, you tarnish God's name. God promises in Isaiah 55:11 that his word will not come back void. It will not come back empty. It will not come back useless. So be faithful to proclaim it and announce it, and God will bless it. It will always bear fruit. And so what a motivation to build an entire ministry upon the word, right? It will not come back empty, God promises. Romans 1:16 says the gospel is the power of God. The gospel shatters stony hearts and gives hearts of flesh. God will honor his word. So Paul says, man, pray that it just goes far and wide. Paul built his entire ministry on the gospel. 1 Corinthians 2:2, he says, I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. What a statement. The only thing I want to know more and more is Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul says, 1 Corinthians 1, I preach the gospel, not in cleverness of speech, because I don't want the cross to be made void. I don't want people following me for my cool speeches. The power is in the gospel. The Jews see it as a stumbling block. The Greeks see it as foolishness. But to those who are being saved, the gospel is the power of God. And so I will continue to preach the gospel, Christ crucified, over and over again, because God will bless his word. If we proclaim the gospel of Christ without any alteration, without any addition, God is faithful to honor it. He will save souls. He will sanctify saints. And Paul saw it in real life in the city of Thessalonica. He went into a pagan city with absolutely no knowledge, prior knowledge of Jesus Christ, and all he was armed with was the gospel. And God honored his word, and people got saved. That's why he says at the end of verse 1, just as it did also with you. Oh, he's like reminiscing. Oh, man, it was so sweet. When I came to Thessalonica and I was preaching that gospel, people were just getting saved everywhere. And maybe Paul right now, as he's writing this, is in a little bit of a dry spell, you know. He's not seeing that advancement that he once saw. And so he's like, oh man, pray. Pray for the word to just shoot through like it did with you. But he knows that if he preaches the gospel, God will honor it, God will use it, God will bless it. He's faithful to. Number three, he's faithful to deliver his servants. To deliver his servants. He says in verse 2 that we will be rescued from perverse and evil men, for not all have faith. That's part of his prayer request. That's what he wants them to pray. Why would he ask them to pray this? Because he knows the Lord's faithful to do it. The Apostle Paul's ministry was fraught with enemies, sufferings, afflictions, hardships. He gives a list of it in 2 Corinthians 11. Just listen to some of this. He says he has stripes. That means whippings to his back. Frequent stints in prison. 5 times, he said, I received 39 lashes from the Jews. 3 times I was beaten with rods. He was stoned with stones. 3 times he was shipwrecked, he says, and he spent an entire day in the sea. Man, I don't know if Paul passed me a ticket to get on a boat with him, I'd probably say, I'll walk. Thank you, okay? Perils on all of his journeys, sleepless nights, hungers, thirst, cold, exposed. That's what he lists in 2 Corinthians 11. And apparently he was going through something similar at the moment he writes this. Because he says we need to be rescued from perverse and evil men. Perverse is the word out of bounds, out of place. It's the word topos, which is where we get topography. The shape and formulation and description of where things are. And he goes, these guys are atopos. They have no place. They're out of bounds. What does he mean? Well, they imprison me for no reason. They fight against me for no reason. They beat me up for no reason. And they're also evil. And evil, pretty self-explanatory, right? They're just in line with Satan and they want to stop the gospel. These are the people. He describes them in 1 Thessalonians 2 as being unbelieving Jews, and they were always the first thorn in his side when he went to a new city. Cause problems, drive him out, etc. And this isn't something minor, because he says, I need rescue. That's the word he used. Rescue, deliverance. This is dangerous. I'm in trouble. He says there at the end of verse 2, not all have faith. That sound you hear is the door slamming shut on universalism. Not all have faith. Not all will be saved. But as he thinks about the faithlessness of his enemies, it triggers in his head the faithfulness of God. Because it says at the end of verse 2, not all have faith. And then verse 3, but the Lord is faithful. And in the original language, there's no verses. There's no punctuations. The Greek language is just straight through. And you're supposed to figure out where a sentence ends and where it begins. And the way it works here is that he ends verse 2 with the word faith. And then verse 3 begins with faith. So it is as if he says, not all men have faith. Faithful is the Lord. Men, these men have no faith, but the Lord is faithful. Turn over just a couple pages to 2 Timothy 3. It's the next book. It's 1 Timothy and then 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy 3 in verses 10 and 11. Read this, 3:10. Now you followed my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance, persecutions and sufferings, such as happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra. Three persecutions, three sufferings in three places. What happened in Antioch? Well, the Jews incited persecution against him and they drove him out. He ran for his life. That's in Acts chapter 13. So what did he do? He went on to the very next city, and the very next city was Iconium, right here listed. Iconium, the Jews incited a riot to stone him. And somehow Paul found out, ran away. It's in Acts chapter 14. And then guess what he did? Went on to the next city. Guess what the next city is? Lystra. And when he gets to Lystra, it's like, oh, you got to be kidding me. Guess who's there? It was the Jews who had come from Antioch and Iconium. They followed him there. And there in Lystra, they stoned Paul with stones, dragged him out of the city, and left him for dead. It's in Acts chapter 14. These sound like epic defeats, don't they? Epic defeats. The Lord has abandoned me. Oh no. What does Paul say there at the end of verse 11? Out of them all, what? The Lord rescued me. It's the same word. Same word as 2 Thessalonians 3. He rescued me. Even with his tremendous suffering, Paul never wavered in that conviction. The Lord is faithful to deliver. He will deliver me. He promised, I'll never leave you or forsake you. And he'll continue to prove that to be true. And someone out there may think, you know, I don't know. The Lord didn't really deliver me. The Lord didn't really rescue me. I mean, look what all has happened in my life. Look at the suffering or hardship that I've been through. Where was the Lord's rescue? And I bet the Lord is probably saying, you should see where you would have been if I had done nothing. The Lord's faithful to deliver his servants. Number four, he's faithful to protect his people. To protect his people. Go back to 2 Thessalonians 3. He says in verse 3, the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen and he will protect you from the evil one. There is evil out there, but there is an evil one as well. The evil one is Satan. He is the adversary. He is the one prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. This is the spiritual battle. This is the spiritual warfare that we are talking about on Wednesday nights. He throws flaming darts and arrows of temptations at God's people, arrows of doubt. He is scheming and planning. He is full of deceptions and lies. And you look at all of that and you go, we are greatly outmatched. But, Paul says, the Lord is faithful to strengthen you and to protect you. Strengthen you means to stabilize you, that you can dig your feet into the ground and not be moved. And that's exactly what the Bible tells us to do in Ephesians chapter 6, the great passage on spiritual warfare. It says we need strength from Him who supplies our strength so that we can do what? Ephesians 6 says, stand firm. Christians stand firm and they resist the evil one. They don't fight against him. They don't rebuke him. They don't cast him out. You hold your ground. And Paul says, the Lord is able to undergird you so that you can stand firm and you can be strengthened so that you can deal with all the onslaughts that the enemy gives you. And he will protect you, he says in verse 3. He will protect you. The Lord guards his people. They may stumble for a short time, but they will never fall away. No one will snatch them out of his hand. I love this in 1 Peter 2:25. The Lord is the guardian of our soul. Isn't that amazing? He guards your soul. The Lord's protection over his people is seen in the way he helps you in times of temptation. 1 Corinthians 10:13. We know this verse well, right? The Lord is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, right? We know this verse. He will provide you the way of escape so that you may endure it. He protects you through it. Does not mean you'll have struggles. Does not mean you are going to have wicked temptations thrown at you. But the Lord protects his people. And if you want to turn again, you can turn to 2 Timothy 4. Just to see this illustrated, 2 Timothy 4. Watch this. Verse 16. At my first defense, no one supported me, but all deserted me. What a statement. All of Paul's friends, they ditched him, they abandoned him. Boy, is that a time for tremendous doubt or what? All my friends left me here. Says in 16, may not be counted against them. Watch this, verse 17. But the Lord stood with me and did what? He strengthened me. Everybody left me high and dry, but the Lord showed up when I needed him the most, and he strengthened me. So that through me, the proclamation might be fully accomplished, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was rescued out of the lion's mouth. In verse 18, the Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. That is the protection that he's talking about. He will bring me safely to his kingdom. No one will stop that, not even the evil one. That's the protection he has for his people. He will keep the evil one from having total victory over you. He will keep you safe. He will make you stand in his presence, Jude 24 says. He is faithful to do that to his people. And now lastly, number 5. Go back to 2 Thess 3. In verses 4 and 5, he's faithful to direct unto holiness. Faithful to direct unto holiness. Verse 4, we have confidence in the Lord concerning you, that you are doing and will continue to do what we command. Emphasis on the readers, right? You guys are going to do what we say. We're giving you these apostolic commands. We need you to obey them. And in verse 5, may the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and the steadfastness of Christ. May God guide you and direct you toward this righteous living. May God clear the way and make the road straight toward holiness. And holiness is a dual process, okay? The individual must live in obedience to what God says. That's clearly what verse 4 says. I want you to do what we command. But it is the Lord at work as well, because the Lord directs the heart, as verse 5 says. You do what you're told, and the Lord will direct your heart to give you the affections for that. And Paul's going to deal with a serious issue coming up. The unruly and laziness of some of the people in the congregation, and really verses 6 through 14, we'll get into that next week. It was causing a lot of problems in the church. And so he's like, man, listen guys, I need you guys to start obeying what we're saying. That's what verse 4 says, right? Do what we command. Verse 6, he's going to say, here's the command. Look, now we command you. Verse 10, we used to give you this order. That's a command. Verse 12, these people we command. I mean, he's going to issue some commands. But in all of that, you know what he leans on? God's faithfulness to guide you into holiness. That's what he leans on. That's what he says in verse 4. We have confidence in the Lord. That's where his confidence lies. My confidence is not in the commands. My confidence is not even in you obeying perfectly. My confidence is in the Lord. The faithfulness of God moving you towards holiness. Yes, you have a role in holiness and in obedience. Yes, you must strive. But friends, my confidence is not in you, he says. It's in the Lord. The Lord said he would purify his people, and that's what I'm resting on, Paul says. And the Lord's faithfulness is the foundation of his wish there in verse 5, his desire. May the Lord, that expresses a desire, a wish that he has. May the Lord direct your hearts. God, I want you to do this. God, direct their hearts into the love of God, the love that he has for us, and the steadfastness of Christ. That's the endurance, the consistency, and all these three areas of holiness. Obey the apostolic commands, know the love of God more and more, and grow in endurance and steadfastness. In all of that, yes, you have a role. You have an individual responsibility to be holy. But Paul's leaning and his dependence is on the faithfulness of Christ to accomplish that in you. Because he can direct our hearts. He can point you toward holiness and guide your heart to want holiness. Isn't that amazing? So people say, well, you know, I know what I should be doing, but I don't feel it yet. I don't feel it. I don't feel like I'm doing right. I don't feel like it's the right thing to do. Friends, start obeying now, even if you don't feel it, and trust the Lord that he's faithful to guide your heart into those affections. He'll direct you toward holiness because he's faithful to do that. The dependence we have is not on the individuals being so strong and so tough and so able. Our confidence is in the Lord, directing the heart. There's a certain Indian tribe that has a unique practice in training young boys to becoming young men. On the boy's 13th birthday, he's blindfolded and he's led miles away into the forest. And only then is he allowed to remove the blindfold, and what he has to do is he has to spend the entire night in the jungle by himself. He has to withstand all the difficulties of the weather, every noise and every sound and every wild animal. Probably keeps him awake all night, the fear of danger, the fear of the unknown, in pitch blackness. Eventually, as the sun rises and light begins to shine on the forest, he sees the path. The path that led him there, the path that will take him back to the village. And as he begins to make his way toward the path, he sees a man standing there in the path with a bow and arrow drawn. And it's his father. His father, unbeknownst to the boy, had been with him all night. The father had been there all along, standing guard, protecting, never leaving him, never losing sight. The boy thought he was all by himself. His father had been right there. In the same way, the Lord is faithful to us. He's ever present. He's always there. He's never leaving. He's never giving up. He's faithful to you. He's faithful to answer our prayers, to honor his word, to deliver his servants, to protect his people, and to guide and direct us unto holiness. And if you and I can reflect honestly for a moment, we think of all the junk in our life that we brought into church today. All the sin and disobedience. And he will not be one drop less faithful to you today than he was yesterday and the way he will be tomorrow. There are some spouses who just kind of reach their end and they say, I can't take it anymore. And they leave a marriage. There are even some parents with a wayward and rebellious child. They say, I can't do it anymore. I separate from them. God is faithful. And he will never leave his people. Let's pray. Father, what a precious text that we can lean on this morning, and what wonderful truth. We see the only reason that we're holding on is because you're holding to us. You're like that Father, always present, always there, always reliable, always keeping your word. Father, may we trust in you more and more. May we never waver in our dependence upon your great faithfulness, God. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to sing a verse from our closing hymn. Blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. He is assuredly there because he is faithful, right? Let's sing it. Let's stand up. Because he is faithful, right? Amen. You are dismissed this morning. We'll see you next time.